Recorded Books presents New Yorkers, A City and Its People in Our Time by Craig Taylor. Narrated by Michael Braun, Ron Butler, Karen Chilton, Andrea Gallo, Catherine Ho, Maria Liatis, Nick Mills, Luis Moreno, Samara Naeymi, and Richard Poe. A quote from Do I Wake or Sleep by Isabel Bolton. What a strange, what a fantastic city. There was something here that one experienced nowhere else on earth. Something one loved intensely. What was it? Crossing the streets. Standing on the street corners with the crowds. What was it that induced this special climate of the nerves? A peculiar sense of intimacy, friendliness, being here with all these people and in this strange place. They touched your heart with tenderness, and you felt yourself a part of the real flight and flutter, searching their faces, speculating about their dooms and destinies. Introduction. One night on a Manhattan-bound F train, a man pushed his way past me. He stumbled, grabbed at a pole for balance, grabbed at it again, succeeded, stood for a few moments, and finally sat. He placed one hand on a yellow plastic seat, stared at it, and said, "More pain." The man lifted his head and addressed a stranger standing nearby. "More pain," he said. When the doors opened at East Broadway, I stepped out before "More Pain" man was pushed onto the platform by the stranger, who followed him for a few steps and kept repeating the words, "I don't want to fight you," before his friends pulled him back onto the F. The train left the station. Now alone, More Pain Man stood on the platform. It was late. The station was empty, so the acoustics were perfect. When he yelled out those same words, a description of what he had already received or a demand for the future, I wasn't sure. "More life," I'd been told when I arrived in New York, and "more of life. You will hold the inside doorknob of your apartment," I was told, "and you will think to yourself, get ready to enter the oceanic power. It's no use arguing with it. It's no use doing anything but relenting, letting it hit you, moving with that force. In New York, you will always get more." New York meant more of everything, more joy, more sorrow, more pleasure, more pain, more experience, more possibilities to find love, more wealth, and a poverty with more of a sharp, punitive edge. Even if, statistically, New York was now smaller than Baoding and Tianjin and Hyderabad and many others, it still overwhelmed in its old, familiar ways. More awe as the skyline rose. More moments of incredulity as light flooded down the canyon of an avenue, and more disgust at what looked to be grease smeared on the back of an Elmo costume in Times Square. More Elmos. More actual height could be found in the skyscrapers of Kuala Lumpur. Still, it just felt like the city held more. More elevators, more LED lights, more nail salons, more rats, more bridges. Over the course of my years in New York, I felt that pain, but also enveloping love, and I got caught up in more diversion than expected. I was awed by what was endlessly offered up. I loved the concentrate. I loved the proximity to strangers, how every day you were inches from weirdness, greatness, and everything in between. It was the greatest ongoing flicker of human life I'd ever encountered. Something or someone came at you in each moment, and what you got, in interactions with the city, was a consistent assault on the senses. Your senses were worked and exercised and reworked every day. I loved the endless sense of "and this-ness," this man, and this woman, and this look, and this detail, and this necklace on that cyclist, and this, a richness that sank down beneath you, till it hit the serpentinite and schist, the Fordham gneiss and Inwood marble and Heartland formation. Until that point, there was always more. And then you crossed to the next block and started the process all over again. This and this and this. All of it was new to me when I moved to New York in January 2014 to start reporting New Yorkers. I had spent the previous decade researching, reporting, and writing two books about other places. They were based on my experiences interviewing a wide array of people to get a feel for their lives, their work, and the places they made. For the first one, Return to Aikenfield, I had spent a couple of months in an English village with hunters, farmers, apple pickers, priests, publicans, teachers and shopkeepers, commuters and retirees, and a gnarled old rag rug maker, all in an effort to capture rural life a generation after Ronald Blythe's classic 1969 book, Aikenfield. As a follow-up, I spent 5 years walking the streets and squares of London, interviewing Londoners. The book that resulted, Londoners, presented a contemporary portrait of the city from more than 80 voices, street sweepers to investment bankers, a manicurist to a dominatrix. Neither of these books were about places I'd grown up knowing. I had moved to London from a seaside village in Western Canada. But not knowing a place, not being of a place, left a space for others to step forward to explain. I imagined there would be no lack of candor. I only knew that I wanted to craft a book about New York in the 21st century, filled with the voices and sounds and places and people of New York, the life of the city right now. A book that would capture the richness of its conversation, the complaints and quiet admissions of a city in flux, and one that would weave together the voices of an enormously diverse city, people from every borough, the rich and the poor, young and old, immigrant voices and native, those emboldened by the city, as well as those who'd felt its sharp edge. It takes one proof of address to get a New York Public Library card. Mine allowed me to keep going back to James Baldwin and Joseph Mitchell and Vivian Gornick and Jacob Rees, Marianne Moore and Edith Wharton and Langston Hughes, Jane Jacobs, Frank O'Hara, Bernard Malamud, Oscar Hiwelos, and Ralph Ellison. I had my own copy of Robert Caro's The Power Broker, and was told that some people couldn't travel with such an enormous book on the subway, so they cut it into thirds. The first incision should be made at page 359, the second at page 828. I kept mine whole. I was also surrounded by the excellent writing about New York City that comes out every month, every week, every day, every few minutes, in the stack of remaining hometown newspapers and magazines, in the New York Times Metro section, as well as the eruption of superb reporting online and on the radio, and the commentary that unfurled on the social media feeds of observant New Yorkers. All of this work is vital, intimidating, often entertaining, but I wanted to find something more direct and to create a kind of oral portrait of the city grounded in the flow of New Yorkers' speech. I took my cue from writers who had walked the streets and done the legwork, from Reese's reports from the filth and degradation of tenement blocks in How the Other Half Lives, and from E.B. White's Here Is New York, a half century later, in which he wrote about strangers who have pulled up stakes somewhere and come to town, seeking sanctuary or fulfillment or some greater or lesser grail. These seekers teemed through New York in the hot summer of 1948 when White wrote the piece. They still fill the sidewalks. It was these sidewalks that seemed to usher forth conversation. I liked books where you could almost see New York conversation rising from the pavement. I started walking the city. And then I started walking with other people and got to feel the incantatory power of New York sidewalks. In one of my many guides, The Odd Woman and the City, Vivian Gornick endlessly walks the streets of New York with her mother because they visit best by walking. Walking brings out the best in us. And then there was the lesson from Joseph Mitchell, whose extraordinary work simply says, in that quiet, persistent voice, go out into the city and listen. I'd enter all these redolent New Yorks of Gay Talese or Sharifa Rhodes pits, feel the frustration of not having gotten here earlier, and mourn my inability to experience the same city. It was overwhelming, even dispiriting. But then I'd say, fuck it. Even the greats had not gotten this New York, this afternoon in Brownsville or Bensonhurst, this person, this moment in their life, this enthusiasm, this incarnation of a grievance, these words. I took it as my task to capture this particular moment of New York. And what a strange and wonderful moment. When I arrived, totems of New York for decades, like Times Square, the taxicab, don't honk signs, were being transformed. And there were monumental physical changes to New York City's infrastructure. The High Line, the World Trade Center site, the new arena and development in downtown Brooklyn, the East Side subway, the revitalization of the waterfront throughout the city. And then there were the more subtle but no less dramatic demographic changes, as gentrification accelerated and the ethnic composition of the city changed. When I moved to New York, it had recently become a majority non-white city. I wanted to create a book that reflected these physical and demographic changes. But I also wondered how the psyche of New York itself was changing, and particularly, how it had been affected by the dramatic convulsions in its recent history. The terrorist attacks of 2001, the blackout of 2003, Hurricane Sandy in 2012, the police killing of Eric Garner in 2014, and then the pandemic, quarantine, and Black Lives Matter protests of 2020 hit. In New York that March, as I scrambled to talk with many of my sources, the city seemed very dark indeed. On a bus in Flushing, I watched a man retrieve his hand from a strap and douse his palm with sanitizer, most of which slithered onto his shoes. More cleanliness, more fear. Each day there were more sirens, and they seemed to grow longer and louder. Every day, the ballet of the sidewalks changed. Some people had started reciting Psalm 23 while washing their hands. Others sang Blitzkrieg Bop. Interviewees working in hospitals described a new jitteriness. Black SUVs started slinking out of town, but the fresh direct delivery guys couldn't escape. What if Yankee Stadium becomes a hospital? Someone asked. A woman working at Best Buy said people were loading up on as much screen as they could. When the restaurants closed, the variety of explanations posted to the doors was another example of the profusion of voice in New York. Handwritten or printed on corporate letterhead, ironic, defiant, or just sad beyond belief. A doctor told me he'd seen patients who were hallucinating as a symptom, as if we all weren't hallucinating. As if the sight of a hospital ship off Manhattan wasn't from an alternate reality, abutting our own. I feared for my list of interviewees. Before long, I received an email from one of them with the subject line, "Something for the book." He was in the hospital with the coronavirus, he said. "Stay tuned," he wrote. Over the course of 6 years, I spoke to more than 180 New Yorkers. Some spoke to me briefly. Others kept the conversation going for years. I ended up filling 71 notebooks and just under 400 hours of tape. I spent what seemed like days on the subway. I cadged rides and caught the odd taxi when I was late, sweaty, confused. I tried to find logic in the streets of Queens. I apologized profusely for miscalculating how long it took to get to the Rockaways. Mainly, I walked and walked and walked. Near the end of the project, I snapped my right Achilles tendon and wondered if it had been from overuse. I was drawn to talkers of all sorts. Who would be better at revealing the churn of the city's past, the variety of its present, and the unknown of its future, than those working to make the city run? I steered clear of commentators, pundits, personalities, functionaries, PR flacks, and city hall reps. The kind of people the writer Ian Sinclair once described as those ironed faces schooled in saying nothing at great length. Everyone wanted to show me how many people they knew, whom they'd collected, who would talk. "You know who would talk?" they'd say, pushing another name on me. They wanted to demonstrate the richness of their New York. They wanted to show their broad and varied city, how many social lines could be easily crossed, or how deep into their own social strata they could dig. "I was just thinking," said one woman, emerging from a reverie, "of all the wonderful people I know. It's not a bad way to spend some time." I chased leads. I talked to strangers. I hung around. I wandered across the boroughs. I set up countless meetings with people in the non-photogenic New York, in Champ's Bar in Penn Station, at the throbbing McDonald's on Southern Boulevard in the South Bronx, outside the Chuck E. Cheese at Barclays Center in Brooklyn. I'd enter into a conversation in the M&M's store in Times Square, the TGI Fridays near Wall Street, Starbucks everywhere. This type of nowhere New York seemed to be always expanding to meet me. Often, the blander the place we'd meet, the more interesting the person and the stories they'd tell. I'd start with pleasantries in a chain cafe, and soon both more of the person and more of the city would be revealed. We'd progress to deeper conversation at Elias Corner in Astoria, or revelation with a rich pasta sauce at Manducati's in Long Island City. Even in the blandest spaces, unexpected language would fly from someone's mouth. Sometimes the backdrops brought the individuals more vividly into focus. In New York, I was told by an ex-cabbie, "The people are the texture." I kept coming back to that line. I learned to believe it. I was led into experiences. I held a rope connected to a giant balloon and walked down Fifth Avenue in the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade. I ate a sandwich at a table covered with multivitamins and composition books in a redecorated room at the Chelsea Hotel. Talked to a woman whose son was in trouble while she packed condoms into a safe sex kit at a safe injection site in Washington Heights. "I'm going to take you on a series of tours," a personal injury lawyer from Queens said, and I spent hours in the passenger seat of his minivan. "Here's the name of the church in Fort Greene," I was told. "Be outside at 9. I said yes to it all. "Yep, I can find that car dealership in the Rockaways. I'll see you there." Stuff happened in one day that couldn't have happened in the same day anywhere else. I told the New Yorkers I talked to, "You get to say what you want. It's your view of the city I want." At a party, a woman asked me, "So are you looking for boldface names?" The person next to her said, "No, he's looking for the lightly italicized." Every day that seemed more apt. I loved listening to people explain what they do. The lightly italicized ways a city makes and remakes itself every day. The New Yorkers I spoke to did their self-mythologizing on the go. They watched their life, related their life, made sure it was already a story, almost before the moment was done. I was in New York to listen to people, but in New York, listening is more like feeling sound surge past. You grab and corral what is spoken. I encountered the opposite of reticence: assertion, self-possession, volume. In New York, it takes very little to bring on the onrush, and I'd marvel at the velocity with which people spoke, the mere speck of time it took for interviewees to get into the personal. I'd put down a little Etirol recorder and let it go, sometimes for hours. Conversations were set down and logged, and the audio was typed up. Those transcriptions contained the interviews, but unlike in London, There were many interjections, dutifully picked up by the mic. This city barged into conversations. People slid in because they couldn't sit nearby in silence. "I was just listening to what you said about radio stations in New York," one woman said from the next table over in a cafe. She couldn't help herself. "Just call me Girl in Cafe," she said. "I want to be known as Girl in Cafe." In many cases, the interviewee peered back at the interviewer. "So what about you?" the Orthodox Lice consultant asked me as she went about her work. "Tell us about yourself." New Yorkers challenged me in ways Londoners never did. Race was not an afterthought or a submerged current. It was right there. "How is your white skin feeling today?" I was asked. "Who are you to ask me that question? And how do you expect to understand this as a white man? And, no offense, but ¿cómo puedo transmitir lo que es esta ciudad a alguien que no es de El Salvador?" From the start, I wondered who even gets to be called a New Yorker. I figured it was the decision of the interviewees to make, not mine. Some had just arrived. Others knew no other place. "One belongs to New York instantly," was the opinion of Tom Wolfe. "One belongs to it as much in 5 minutes as in 5 years." Sure, but some shrugged off the term. Others felt the label would never apply to them. Maybe their children would call themselves New Yorkers or Americans. Some thought they'd lost their right to it, or they were uninterested. They just wanted to get on with their work. London had insinuated like damp. New York hit. It celebrated hitters. One of my first interviews took place at Jimmy's Corner in Midtown, a bar whose walls are covered with photos of the best. In my new apartment building, the faded clippings taped to the side of the boiler were Gary Carter, Daryl Strawberry, Reggie Jackson, Alex Rodriguez with an X across his face. On the streets outside, New York unapologetically hit. Wind to face, garbage to nose. Some 75 New Yorkers appear in New Yorkers. I was surprised by how many of them told me they could teach me something. Sometimes the lesson was practical. How to recycle cans, how to steal a car, how to walk the crowded sidewalks without bumping into anyone. But often it was something profound. How to be compassionate, how to live artfully, how to live an uncompromising life. The advice may have been particular to this city, but a New York life well lived was an accomplishment like no other. Many of them told me I'd missed the real New York. By a couple years, or by a decade, or by several decades. New York was better before, they'd say. Or, you should have known Avenue C when it was, and he'd waggle his hand. Or, you should have known Jackson Heights when it was, and he'd give the thumbs up. "This is good," one woman said and gestured to the noodles spread on her plate. But Flushing isn't what Flushing was. The place with the good pupusas in the Bronx? Of course it was gone by the time I arrived. It's always gone. It's just a playground for the rich. Nearly everyone I spoke to said something similar, like a forlorn chorus resounding across the boroughs, as if a nurse in Inwood and an old Irishman in the Rockaways made a pact to speak the same phrase with the same amount of venom. It's just a playground for the rich. Until you take the private elevator and step into the scented apartment, and the well-moisturized man says, "You know, it's not even that great a playground for us these days." The New Yorkers I spoke to thought their city was actually slipping. It was happening within their lifespans. They were witnessing deforestation of their shops, the killing off of diverse species. One mentioned air people, those you used to see walking the streets of Manhattan, whose presence made you think, what do they live on? Air? Some people needed to expunge their personal list of what was gone, to get it out there and acknowledged, to say the names of the missing and the dead, out of reverence and respect. It was instructional. It was about status, too. You will never know this city like I know it, never love it like I love it, never have seen and lived through these spaces like flowers that dazzled and were gone. I knew this place before it was nail salons. That was repeated a couple times to show me what was what. Change cut. Change reshaped. Change pushed people farther out. This stop, one guy said in Forest Hills, is where you get on the E at 5 a.m., and all the guys working in kitchens in Midtown are bundled up and sleeping. And then I was told that change was the only continuing attribute. Don't listen to them. Part of loving New York is just mourning the hell out of it. The mourning is the love. In this way, they were engaging in an age-old trait of the true New Yorker, a heartfelt mix of mourning and celebration. As Colson Whitehead has written, no matter how long you have been here, you are a New Yorker the first time you say, that used to be Muncie's, or that used to be the TikTok lounge. That before the internet cafe plugged itself in, you got your shoes resold in the mom-and-pop operation that used to be there. You are a New Yorker when what was there before is more real and solid than what is here now. That internet cafe? It's now a nail salon. But the people I talked to were also full of vigor, gall, and drive. New Yorkers were often defined by their desire. I'm going to get it, or at least I'm going to try. It was a place so powerful, I saw a man fresh from prison upstate asking for the city's forgiveness. Let me back in, New York. Let me return to who I was. Let me experience more of you again. For a while, I lived near Grand Street, close enough to the Williamsburg Bridge to hear its oceanic rush. I often ran into the rabbi who lived on the second floor and his kids, who rolled their tzitzas in their fingers as the slowest elevator in New York rose. They pressed their faces up against the window when I walked toward the front door. In the autumn one year, my father visited from Canada. One afternoon, my downstairs neighbor negotiated her walker into the elevator just as my father and I were about to ascend to the ninth floor. She looked him over, inquired about his health, where he was from, what he did before he retired. When the elevator hit the fourth floor, she said, I've had the nicest time talking with you. Would you mind if I carried on up to the ninth? She did. She stared at him. And one day the next week, while I was retrieving mail from my mailbox, I heard the approach of her walker and the clink of the segments of her long necklace. Craig, she said, I had the most wonderful time speaking to your father the other day. Now tell me, is he single? It seemed fitting that a city that always had more to offer seemed so often to leave its people hungry for more. New York seemed to work its residents hard, to mold their bodies, their decisions, their careers. I saw the evidence of the force in the marks it left, beating some with a poverty-hating mercilessness that shouldn't have existed in the U.S., transforming some into imperious figures. Some felt the ghosts of an older city press against them. I met people who wanted those ghosts, who courted those ghosts, who loved the idea of a city not only their own, but inherited and pulsing with the past. I kept running into people who were acutely aware of their role in propping up the city, adding to a now that had no choice but to be polyphonic and rich, adding to the history, leaving a mark. One man ran a fabrication company in Long Island City and worked with a library of all the different stones of the city. I saw that library. It stretched across the wall, brown stones and grays and dusty whites. And when I was up on the eighth floor of a building site on the Upper East Side with him, looking past the flapping tarps onto the streets below, he told me about a cornice piece he'd once replaced. The terracotta at the time of installation had been soft, and when he removed the piece, he saw nestled in the corner, all the thumbprints of those who had first installed it. The ridges of the fingerprints were still legible. He thought for a moment about all the fingers that had left those prints. Then he took the cornice away, measured its length, and added the new piece. You worked with the stuff of the New York you got. You worked with the materials of your present, and then you left, or you died, or you moved to Florida, or your visa ran out. You worked with the electrics, or the sewage, or on Broadway, or with New York's dog population, or you worked to ensure its elevators ran smoothly, or you worked in the courtrooms with the city's elderly. You opened its doors. You pressed hard. You left an impression. In the end, though I thought I could simply interview people to get a sense of what New York is like now, it was, of course, more complicated than that. It wasn't easy to turn off the encounter when I turned off my recorder. It wasn't easy to stop caring, and unlike London, people didn't quickly let go. If I was taking something from them, that was the implication, they were going to ask for something in return. One year I ate Christmas dinner with Elliot Carter, a man who'd grown up in Brownsville, had been homeless, and now made a living, a sort of living, anyway, by recycling. I'd gotten to know Elliot well, and for years we'd met up for Cubanos on Avenue C. Sometimes we'd go return cans at a Duane Reade near 14th Street, or I'd eat lunch with him up in the Bronx. Once, during my father's visit, Elliot had dropped off ribs he made with his mother's recipe. I was around to see him hard at work. He was around when I was packing up to leave the city. Like the city itself, there was always more to Elliot. He was inexhaustible. He was the complete New Yorker. He was always leaning back to say, "The thing about New York is..." And I got the sense that we could go on for another 3 years, another decade, eating Cubanos, looking out at the sidewalk, spearing plantain slices, and he'd dredge something up from within him. "The thing about New York is..." "You are part of this too," he said to me once. "You are a part of this thing now." "Not an important part," I said. He waved me away. "You're in this city now too. You're a voice." We were walking toward the bodega near my apartment that was kept under eternal scaffolding with a clamped car marooned out front. Two elderly men were propped against the car in their sweaty Yankees jerseys. I told Elliot I was leaving New York. My visa was running out. I left, but Elliot was still in it. There would always be more cans, certainly more pain, more hassle, more fear from the virus, more crowds, more uncertainty. But sometimes he conveyed to me what he knew was more transcendence. The look of the Bronx in the morning, Battery Park at twilight. You just keep going. I left a lot of stuff behind. Elliot took a rice cooker off my hands. Now I text him when I want to know the temperature of the city and how that old machine is doing. "Still cooking," Elliot says. "Still cooking." Overture. A Sense of the City.
Frank Sr., a singer. My seeing eye dog and I, we'll walk from 125th Street down to Houston Street. The sound of children in the park tells me what time of day it is. Maybe it's afternoon. You can hear that in kids' voices. Morning, you can hear the horns, the hustle. Nighttime, you don't hear trucks as much. The traffic is lighter. Now, if you just drop me out of the sky, maybe I wouldn't know if it's rush hour in the morning or in the evening. But I know it'd be one of those. Then you go by the feel of the sun. When I'm walking, construction is the hardest thing. 'Cause you can't hear. You gotta fight your way. I don't even know what I pass. The cane is hitting everything. And I'm walking much slower. You have to concentrate that much more with the cane. So when you're trying to concentrate and you hear jackhammers and trucks and banging and you smell the construction, your concentration's gone. With the dog, I don't have to worry about that stuff. We just breeze by. When I pick my dogs, when they match me up, I always make sure they give me a dog that can move fast. I need speed. Don't give me a dog that can't go any faster than a stroll. I want to move. We get on Fifth Avenue and we just move, man. She loves going in and out of the people. You feel yourself going around the people. She's shooting up in the corner, boom. The light changes and she's gone. The people are just stepping off the curb. I'm hearing them behind me saying, "Oh, that's a pretty dog you've got there." I'm already by them. I'm moving faster than New York. If I'm walking with the cane, I'm very slow. So that's when I can feel New York going by me. When I go to another city, I feel like I could slow down. I like it because I don't feel like I'm competing. In New York, I'm just in it. As we walk, I hear the different kinds of neighborhoods. Black people turning into white people. Spanish people turning into black people, you know. And then you got the sounds of the languages, the vendors, the different ways that the different cultures sell their stuff. I used to be able to pick out if someone was biracial. They just had a texture in the voice, and a clarity in the voice, and a thickness in the voice that would say, "This is both." Now it's harder to do because everybody's mixed now. The New York voice has changed because everybody's so mixed. Mixed races, mixed cultures. When it was more New Yorkish here, you could hear the different parts of where you're from. Brooklyn had that thing. The Bronx was close, but it was a different kind of an A sound, you know. Black people had their own flavor. Now I couldn't tell a Bronx guy from Manhattan or Brooklyn. You can smell gas leaking from buildings. You can smell tenement, the smell of mold. But then you can go to Central Park and smell the flowers. Smell the grass, the dew. If you go to smoke on 105th Street, you can smell the instruments in there. Horns have like, I don't know how you say, a dry saliva smell. A trumpet smells different than a sax. The trumpet you smell more. A guitar has a smell, like the strings, the wood. I used to perform at this place, Roth's Steakhouse, up on 93rd in Columbus. I was there 7 years. Each set would be different. The first set, you'd hear the plates and people chewing and talking amongst themselves as the music was playing. The second set would be bright, loud. Everybody's drinking now. It got more crowded. Now I'm singing stuff that's more up. Then the third set, it was just freestyle. From set to set, the smells would change. The people, especially when they came in, they were fresh. They'd take off their coats, they'd sit down. They'd be sipping on their little drink. They'd be eating now. The food smells are starting to get on them. Now they're feeling no pain. Their vibe and the smell would change because the liquor changes the chemistry of the perfume. The sweating of the body changes the chemistry of the perfume. It's more of a subtle smell. Now you don't smell it as much, but you know it's there. In Hell's Kitchen, you'd pass all the railroad apartments and tenement buildings and people sitting on the stoop playing checkers or dominoes. You could hear dominoes. You could hear the checkers. And then you could hear who's playing them. Because Spanish people love dominoes. You hear them talking Spanish, but banging the dominoes. Boom, boom, boom. You hear them slamming the checkers. They'd be all over the stoop. They'd be sitting on a car. I used to go up to the Empire State all the time. On the top, you're dealing with wide open sound. It's got a peacefulness about it. I always go to the pier down by the seaport to sit by the river and listen to the boats, listen to the water. It's so beautiful. But you go on a cruise somewhere on real beautiful water, water that's real, and you realize how dirty this smells. You're like, "Oh shit, it's atrocious." I've been living in the city all my life, when Times Square was, you know, the dump. When you got off the bus at Port Authority, it smelled like sex. I used to say, "This is what tourists have to come into?" I would freak out. It just smelled nasty. Sex, groin, and hair, and underarm. You name it, that's what it smelled like. That's how bad Times Square was. It was horrible. I didn't know it till I'd go away and come back. Then you'd say, "Wow, This city stinks. Everybody has a body chemistry, and everybody tries to bring it out with the various oils, colognes, perfumes, pheromones. I don't remember names, but I know what I'm smelling. I love vanilla. I love wood-aged colognes. And in the summer, all the sunscreen's going at you. I met this girl who has no smell. She doesn't wear any cologne or perfumes. So when she walked by me, I said, "I don't get it. I don't feel you." She goes, "Because I don't wear anything." It was an unbelievable feeling to walk next to someone who had nothing on. She was almost a ghost. Weird thing happened to me the other day. I was standing on Madison and 23rd. I came up to the corner and the dog kind of like, I felt her head move someone over a bit so we could fit in. So I said to the person, "Oh, damn," just to say something, because I knew we hit him a little bit. "This is 23rd? I mean, I knew it was, but I was just letting him know I knew we made contact. And he goes to me, "What are you, blind or something?" I started to say, "Fuck you," but said, "Yo, man, what do you think I got the dog for?" He goes, "Oh, you got a dog? I'm blind too." He said, "I was going to ask you to help me cross the street." I said, "I can do that. I can help you across the street, man." He grabbed my arm, held it tight, and we went across.
Itamar Kubovi, a dance producer. In New York, you're in a million situations a day where you have to adjust your body to the reality of the situation. And in and of itself, that's choreographic. You're improvising some kind of physical choreography, and it becomes more forced because there's not a lot of room. So getting into an elevator, getting into a subway, making your way through a subway turnstile, negotiating who's going to go through the exit, that weird moment where you're like, "No, me, no, you." And then you think about race, age, color, privilege, money. There are these weird little political dances about how to quickly negotiate your way through. A big source of choreographic inspiration comes from constraint, literally physical constraints. If you have to pass through a narrow space, you're going to twist your body to do that for a completely practical reason. You just want to keep going, you know? Or you want to riptide across a group of people walking down the sidewalk, and you've got to have some sort of a riptiding strategy. You can't just barrel through. You kind of have to be like, excuse me, or move away. Or there's a spot. I'm going to just dart there and wait, and then I'm going to wait for my next spot. So that all becomes almost inevitable, and I think part of what's interesting in the city is that the theatricality of New York is an inevitable thing. It's not like someone decided to do it because they had like a funny character. It's theatrical because there's no other way to solve the problem other than to declare what you are and what you need and what space you're going to need to do it. And then to hope that you're able to actually get that. Yesterday, I was at a coffee shop on the Lower East Side getting a cup of coffee, and one of the guys who worked there was one of those barista-ish, fancy, it takes them way too long to make your cup of coffee because it's good kind of thing. He was dancing back there, and I don't just mean a grace. In fact, it was quite awkward, but everything he did, he reached, lunged, and then put the cup down, click, 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 and turned around. Everything became this kind of routinized dance for him that was both a performance for the clientele but also a performance for himself. He was making his own space. He was decorating his own space. And you sense that the person that was most being served by his dancing was him. Like, that's what kept him engaged. I sat there with a friend and I was like, "Look at this guy. Every move, from the rinsing of the thing, to the this of the thing, to the that of the thing, it was almost worth going to watch this guy do this weird dance, because it's just such an odd kind of way of making a cup of coffee." There are constantly situations that force this. Density is always the one reason. Elevators become a very big choreographic endeavor. Busy sidewalks are obviously ones. When you have a certain responsibility for space that you need to preserve in order to get something done, you very often need to change your approach to the choreography. If you need to carry something somewhere, or you need to transport something somewhere, or even you need to take a child somewhere, or you need to take three children somewhere, suddenly your whole sense of yourself as a body expands in some imaginary way to envelop the added responsibility of what you have. And this poses a whole new set of considerations about what the most effective way to move around this city is going to be. You not only have this kind of personal choreography, but there's also a molecular choreography. Sometimes we're part of a larger thing that needs to address its movement now as a larger organism. You want to stay close to the people that you trust, and you want to stay away from the people that you don't. And that has a whole influence on what that flow is like. We think often of the challenges from a choreographic point of view as being really dependent on what it is that you're trying to move, more than on the sort of constitution of the person who is moving. Because, in a way, the river washes you along. And you can be a better swimmer or a worse swimmer, but the speed of the river is the speed of the river. One of the things about New York's anonymity and cruelty and, in a way, beauty is that it won't ever stop for you. It won't ever stop. You can come, you can go. Nothing matters to the city. That's one of the great things about it. When things matter a lot to you, sometimes it's nice to be in a world that doesn't care. It's relieving. Cook Monster de Illest, a rapper. To mix Spanish music with English music, start a whole new genre, that's what I want to do. I want to be in history, man. All the friends that I was running into as a young boy, everybody did music. Everybody wants to do music, everybody sings, everybody raps, but not everybody's good. Even if they're a bad rapper, you gotta respect the hustle. There's a lot of bad rappers out there who are persistent. They work harder than most rappers do now. They're not gonna make it, no. You understand what I'm saying? But they still work, so you have to respect it. Everybody's somebody's favorite artist. In my music, I'm talking about my neighborhood. I'm talking about New York. I'm talking about life. Everybody can relate to something. Whether you're rich, poor, hungry, stomach full, good shoes, bad shoes, good car, no car, everybody can relate to something that I say. And that's what I try to rap about. Life, on life's terms. Pain, the struggle. I know what it is to starve. I know what it is to be homeless. I know what it is to sleep on a roof, a bus, a train. I'm not going to say what else I know about. You know what I'm saying? This is New York, man. This is the home of the spit game. The lingo is crazy out here, right, bro? The language, how we speak is different. You know what I'm saying? Uptown, downtown, what's good, Flea? What's good, Mo? What's poppin', boy? What's rockin', huh? It's crazy. I mean, New York, man, dollar slices. Dollar slices, you heard? 24 hours. They take a two-hour break, clean up, close down. The other people come up and open up. Dollar slices all day, all night, 24-7, all around transportation. Prostitutes, liquor stores, Lucy spots. If you don't got money to get a motherfucking pack of cigarettes, you go outside and get three cigarettes, two cigarettes. You know what I'm saying? Bootleg liquor spots, weed spots, crack spots, dope spots, hoe spots, other spots. This city is where all the major films, all the major artists, all the major book writers, all the major songwriters, all the major painters, all the main chefs, all the main maids, servants, butlers and drivers, escorts, bus drivers, train workers, store owners, all types of business owners. This is where everybody wants to have something at. This is the most productive city in the world. Maybe some cities in other countries make more money than New York City, but the lifestyle that we show you, that we give you, there's a ghetto everywhere. There's a hood everywhere. There's drugs everywhere. We just do it a different way. We make everything look different. We make eating look different. You see how we grab that spoon? You see how we grab that fork and that knife? You see how he poured that salt and that pepper? Why he put ketchup on everything, hot sauce? Come on, man. We make it look good, baby, everything. There's nothing like it, I'll tell you that. It's the way we say it. It's the way we express ourselves. It's so much different shit going on out here that everybody got to create their own wave. And once you create a wave, like Max B said, wavy and all that shit. The way I'm saying it now, you could put it in as Ling. Once you create your own Ling and you run with it, then you have a whole bunch of other followers running with whatever you run with and with what you created. New York City, it's the capital of the world. It's the way we talk. It's the way we walk. It's just the lifestyle. We gotta be loud, man. We grew up next to train stations. We can't fucking hear shit. We grew up next to train stations, buses passing, all types of cars, bikes with motors on them, fucking motor scooters, mopeds. Who you know doesn't wheelie on a moped? I know somebody that does. This is New York. All you gotta worry about is having a roof over your head, food in your stomach, and clothes on your back. Something to watch on the TV, something to listen to on the radio. That's about it. Now all the other shit, it comes within time. That's what you save money for. You just make sure your living necessities is taken care of. You can pay another extra month on top of your rent, do it. That will give you some free time to play around and have fun and then buy expensive shit or live an expensive lifestyle. If you don't have an expensive income, don't live an expensive lifestyle because it's not going to work out for you, especially in New York City. This city will drain you out of your last dollar with no remorse. It ain't no, I'm sorry. It's just, bye. Thank you for this money. Have a good time. Come back. Holla at me when you get your next paycheck or when you get your next dollar. I'd be glad to take it.
Joy Kang, a doctor. I grew up in Queens, but I wanted to get out from New York City. I was like, there's something greater than this, something better than what New York City can offer. New York City is rich in terms of culture and a lot of different things, but I wanted to go away. So I moved to Florida. I was so disappointed. Everything was so far away. It was beautiful, but the houses were ugly looking. I hated Florida. Then I did my residency in Illinois. I lived in an area where the entire city was two blocks. The fanciest restaurant was in a strip mall. I was surrounded by cornfields. Everything revolved around food. It was like, let's hang out and eat. 6 months of the year, it was so cold, you could see ice literally being created when you poured water on the street. It was bone cold coldness. I moved to California, where I trained in HIV medicine. People were extremely friendly there. Everyone was like, oh, let's have lunch. But I wanted to know when and where. They were like, whenever, yeah, wherever. It was just like that. So I came back to New York. I don't see myself as a true New Yorker. In California, when I was thinking about coming back, I was like, am I a New Yorker? If you Google it, like, how New Yorker are you? There's this website that has a little online survey. I did it with my friend, who actually was from New York. She wanted to stay in California, and I wanted to come back to New York. We both did it. She was 30% New Yorker. I was 70% New Yorker. I was like, but I don't think like a New Yorker anymore. New Yorkers are go-getters, right? I'm not like that. When you think of a New Yorker, you think of someone who's angry all the time, aggressive, will do anything to get what you need or what you want. I don't see myself as that. I think, perhaps in a more polite and diplomatic way, I am, but not. Well, I no longer walk fast. I used to walk so fast. I can, but I just, it's not natural anymore. Sometimes I have to consciously think, oh, I'm in New York. I've got to walk fast. People say you've got to have thick skins in New York City. If somebody spits at you, you move forward. I have those moments too. If you know who you are, if you're confident of who you are, then you'll be okay, regardless of what other people say. Of course, you've got to still do what you've got to do. That's the hard balance. I'm learning that. And I want to continue to help my patients and also my students and other people that come along the way in my life. My perspective has changed. Instead of taking it as it is, I began to observe and I analyze. Why is that person this way? Why are they acting that way? Why are they so busy? Even at work, I wonder, why do you need to do that to prove that you are good at what you do? Why can't we just focus on three things and be good at them? Well, everybody else is doing a million things, so we've got to do 1,050,000 things. I still strive for excellence. Please, don't doubt that. But it's no longer a competition for me. I used to think New York City was such a dirty place, but now I find it tearfully beautiful. I sometimes actually cry when I'm walking or when I'm looking at the skyline. I don't think I ever appreciated that. I'll be driving by, say, Amsterdam Avenue on the Upper West Side, and it's quiet on Sunday evening. You see these lights, and you see apartments, and not many people are walking. It's just beautiful. My family now lives in Jersey, so I purposely come back in the evening on the George Washington Bridge. The lower deck, not the top deck, because I'm average height. If you're tall, you could actually see the view better, but my height, I cannot see it, so I go on the lower deck. I purposely drive slowly, and I enjoy the view. I tell myself, oh my gosh, I love New York. There are times I really get teary. Even the dirtiness itself, I think it tells a story of someone throwing away. Why did that person litter like that? If you go to Central Park, to the ice skating rink in the park, you can go and observe. There are Caucasian, Black, Hispanic, Asian, mixed race people. Everybody's so nice to each other, picking up each other. It's overpriced, but you know, everybody mingling together in this tiny place, enjoying the ice and the scenery. I mean, it's not like Paris, but it's still beautiful to me.
Danny Dillon, a connoisseur. My whole family is from Washington Heights. My father's family is Puerto Rican, and my mother's family is Irish Catholic. My mom makes Irish soda bread, and on St. Patrick's Day, corned beef and cabbage. My paternal grandmother had a narrow kitchen always full of Sazon Goya packets. She would use all different kinds of classic Goya seasonings. This is not farm-to-table Puerto Rican food. She had all the pots and pans in the oven, always a frying pan on the stove with an inch of oil that she would reuse. To me, New York food is really Puerto Rican food. Pastelitos de carne or pastelitos de queso y guayaba. So she would do white cheese and guava paste. Or she would do a picadillo, like a minced meat. Usually white rice, but sometimes arroz con gandules. But that was specifically for Christmas or holidays, which is the yellow rice. It has the fish and peas and all of that. Tostones and maduros, of course. And she would do both because there were taste preferences in the families. She would do these beautiful home-cooked meals, but she also would have so many packages of cookies and hostess cakes, Twinkies and honey rolls, in plastic, like you get at bodegas. Nothing feels quite the same way New York feels in terms of the food that is everywhere. But you can't have all of the best next door, right? It's not possible to live in one neighborhood that has amazing everything. You have to travel. And part of it, I think, is the trip, the journey to get there. The best bagel place is in Manhattan, up on 108th and Broadway. Absolute Bagel. Everyone always rivals it with Essa Bagel, but the texture is different. A really good bagel has a unique texture that you can't get unless you have the process right. They're bready and fluffy and chewy in all the right ways. It's such a special chew. It satisfies in the same way a really thick rice noodle satisfies. I have the fortune of living really close to Ugly Baby, which does incredible northern Thai food. But I also go to Jackson Heights and Elmhurst in Queens for rice noodles, because that area is incredible. You have a Thai community, a Chinese community, Colombian, Ecuadorian, and all Central and South America. Mexican, too, if you go a little farther up to Corona. Indian. Tibet, actually. There's all these momos around there, too, which are delicious. There's a lot of Ecuadorian street carts there that do the big choclos, the big corn. The Ecuadorian street carts are not to be confused with the trucks. They're like a hot dog cart, retrofitted to serve Ecuadorian food. Ecuadorians have the big pieces of corn. They grill it or have it fried up with really strange little crispy bits that are delicious. In the subway, there are the churros carts, but not traditional churros, the big ones that are doughy and filled with something. The ladies who have the carts will do atol, almost a porridge, a to-go thing in the morning because you can drink it, but it's substantive. And in the summer, the mango con chile y limón. The person I talk to the most about all this is my partner, Ernesto. He and I disagree on a lot of things when it comes to food. He's a Costa Rican, and he's lived in lots of different neighborhoods in the city. We have this big argument about pupusas. They are delicious, Salvadoran, usually with cheese or beans or something in the masa, and you griddle it. Ernesto is obsessed with pupusas. He lived in Washington Heights, so he has a place up there that he loves. But we also go down to Red Hook in the summer. There's a food cart, El Olomega, that does them only on the weekends, and they're my favorites personally. But he works in Industry City, and there's a place down there that has them. I stand by El Olomega. It has the best flavor in the actual masa, the best texture. There's the pupusa, but then you always get the tomato sauce to go with it, and the curtido, like slaw. So I evaluate a place on not only its pupusa, but also on the quality of that tomato sauce and the curtido. If one of those pieces is not good, it ruins the experience. I've got a little bit of a New York bravado. You own your point, right? You own your opinion. Even if there's a little seed deep down inside where you're like, I know that maybe they're right too. No, you don't ever let that in. That is a distinctly New York thing. Just full trust in that you're right. Defending food preferences and food choices, what is the best and what's not, requires the same level of confidence. I am right about the pupusa. Ernesto is wrong. He can have his opinion, but I'm not going to change mine. I'm not going to concede my position on this.
Gus Powell, a photographer. Taking a photograph is like pointing a finger at something and saying, "This is interesting." I learned so many different things from Joel Meyerowitz, but one thing that really stuck with me was this idea that whenever you pick up a camera, point it at something, and press that button, you're saying, yes. You're saying, I believe in this. There's something significant. I embrace it. As you evolve, you point your finger at subtler and subtler things. In the beginning, it's the Empire State Building that's interesting, or the pretty girl, or the man that falls down. Your sensibilities change, and I think what I try to do now is to point my finger at things that aren't even there. Use the camera to make an observation, or to give importance to something that everybody else would let pass by. That's embracing the quotidian poetry of New York. At a certain point, I had begun taking pictures on the street, but I didn't necessarily know what I was doing with them. Then I had this poetry friend from college who sent me Frank O'Hara's lunch poems, which were all written in Midtown on O'Hara's lunch hour. They weren't necessarily documentary in the sense of describing exactly what happened. They were very intimate and personal about him feeling something. He made those poems when he was at the Museum of Modern Art. I was then working at the New Yorker on 42nd Street, Midtown. It was kind of the same space, but with 30 or 40 years between. That small book became this passport for me. I kept it on me and would walk around with it. I started making pictures on my lunch hour. Some days I had 15 minutes, and some days I could sneak away for 2 hours, but it meant that it was this one pocket of time when I had to try and feel something and see something. Sometimes that was as small a thing as just, what does it look like to take these five people who have nothing to do with each other and try to organize them into a picture that has meaning in some way, so that those five people are now forever set together, endlessly having to deal with each other in the photograph? I have this one picture of a woman who's essentially passed out lying down on the steps of the New York Public Library. It's the middle of the day. She's a tourist. She's asleep. You can go up and take pictures of her, and it's like shooting fish in a barrel, but what does that do? If you have the confidence or the interest to know that she's not going to go anywhere, you put her anywhere in the frame. Your viewer will find her. The same way you found her as you walked down the street. They will find her. What can you add to it? Then you push her to the side of the frame, and then you see this other guy walking out of the door, and he's in a suit, and he has some dignity, and he's looking for somebody. Then you have him. Then other people are crisscrossing in the foreground. All of the sudden, you have these three elements in play, and then you use the camera to stop it all. That way of catching one fish to then catch another, to then catch another. New York is an incredibly generous place. I'm inherently an optimist. The sidewalks are generous. The light is generous. The people are generous. This is why you can get things done here. There's so many opportunities as a photographer. You go other places and it's like squeezing water from a stone. Whereas here, it just keeps coming and coming and coming. Some days there ends up being this proprietary moment when you feel like New York. It's all for you. You'll even walk past another photographer and you can tell the way they're holding the camera and the way they're looking at the world, and they'll just nod like, yeah, this is all for us. This is like Disneyland. We all use our cell phones now. If you see somebody using a payphone, you know they're really in fucking trouble. The stakes are higher. Whereas in the past, we all went up to a payphone. You put in a quarter, or you dropped a dime, and you made a call. I remember seeing payphones that I had certain conversations at, and if you walk past them, you remember those conversations. I remember one time going up to a payphone on Canal Street. This woman was on it, and she was crying, and then she got off. I went up to use it, and I picked up the receiver, and it smelled like her chewing gum. It was the whole residue of her tears, her chewing gum, all of it. It was like, this is a confession booth where there's someone on the other side. There it is. I still see that spot, and the phone booth, it's gone. New York is a stream, and you find your spots in the pools where there's a little shade and there's a little light, and there's something that stays. My camera is usually set at 12 feet away, which is this perfect amount of space where I see you, but I'm not necessarily interested. It's also head to toe. I have a couple of pictures that I've named 5th Avenue Freeze or 6th Avenue Freeze, because at one point, I realized that this idea of the architectural shard, we have these things from antiquity where it's just a shard of a frieze that was a significant story. We don't know the story anymore. Maybe we do, because it's a Greek myth or whatever. But there's all these people head to toe in silhouette, and they're telling the story of a battle, or a myth, or this, or that. Then I feel like that's what I've tried to do with photographs sometimes. Take 6 or 7 people, show them head to toe, and say this is like this little frieze. It's this little narrative moment that says something. My pictures are rarely about a single person. They're usually about a collection of people and finding a moment. So sometimes when people ask me, are you taking my picture? I'll say, I took your picture, but it wasn't about you. It was about him and her and this and a tree and all these things combined. If I wanted your picture, I would ask you, but I wanted all of this, and I'm here and you're here. Sometimes they still are angry, and other times they're just like, whatever, okay, fine. I had this moment with this guy handing out flyers near Saks Fifth Avenue. Did you take my picture? I was like, well, yeah, you're in the picture, but I'm like you. I'm out here trying to take advantage of all the stuff that's passing. Because the guy said, you owe me. You owe me for taking my picture. I said, if I owe you, I owe all these people. I owe everyone. You know what? I do. But I owe everyone. The guy looked at me like I was weird and backed off. Then it was maybe 2 weeks later, and I was photographing on the same corner, he came up to me. I was thinking about what you said. He goes, I owe all these people too. That's New York, right? Yes, I am taking that person's picture and that person, but my interest is in the plasma of New York. I try to make pictures where you have multiple people that have nothing to do with each other, that just crisscross in a transitory moment. But often, because you can't really look at seven people, you look at the negative space. You look at the space between people as a singular object, and you find a moment when all of that feels right. There's a charge between them, and you can't see it all, but there's intuitive moments when you feel the gravity, and you can see this one singular larger object. That, for me, is the plasma that we share. That is the negative space between multiple people. And that's what I'm looking for. Part 1. Chapter 1. Nonstop Hustle.
Antoine Shavers, a recent arrival. I moved here 4 months ago from Little Rock, Arkansas. What did I know of New York growing up? Not much. I heard that when you go there, it's like there are great opportunities for you if you want to become an actor, a singer, or a model. You can link up with a lot of people, and you'll be able to try to work your way up to the top. Me personally, my reason for being here is I want to be able to be my own musician, because I love to sing, and I want to be able to work with other singers or other artists out there. It took me 2 days to get here. I rode the Greyhound. I went past places I never been before. Cincinnati, Ohio, Nashville, Tennessee, New Jersey. Ultimately, it was like 5 states I passed. In Ohio, it stops by a stadium. You stretch your legs and then you go right back. I had got me a little munch and crunch, went to the convenience stores. They also had some stuff inside the Greyhound station, so I got me something to eat and got back on the bus. I sat next to some people who'd never been to New York before, some people who was going to other states and whatnot. It was like a little road show, meeting new people on the bus. They was like, "You must be going for a good purpose." And I was like, "Yeah, I'm trying to become a singer." They said, "Yeah, that'll work out for you," and do. And I was starting to believe them. I'm like, okay, I think this is going to be a good decision for me. They told me to be careful because New York can chew you up, eat you alive. They told me to watch out for the scammers, because there are mad scammers in New York. For example, there's this thing they do. They ask you for your credit card, and what they do, they say if you give them $45, they are going to end up giving you $500. All they need is your bank card. And then once they get your PIN number and everything, they find a way to hack into the bank system, or whatever you call it, and they end up getting the money. It's crazy. So many people fall for it. When I came across it, I'm like, "You must think I'm stupid." I'm not stupid at all. There's like 5 people since I've been here tried to get me to do that. That's another thing that people said when I was on the Greyhound bus, too. They was like, "Don't put yourself in a bad predicament, because it's hard to get out of it, especially while you're staying in New York." That's why so many people do things they don't want to do, to at least have a place to stay. I'll try to get my butt a job. When I stepped off the bus in New York, it was unbelievable. It looked just like it did on TV. I'm like, "Oh my God." I was so surprised. It was beautiful. To this day, being in my 4th month period of being here, it's like still unbelievable. Every time I wake up in the morning, I always say to myself, "Wow, I'm actually here in New York." Because I always dreamed of being here, and I'm actually here. And I'm actually, you know, trying to make it. I feel like I'm in a movie. In the subway, everybody have a story to tell. Even if they're not even saying anything, you can just see the story. Like, I see a story of sadness. A woman, she's sitting down on the bus or the train crying, or just listening to the sad music and everything. And you can obviously tell that she's going through something really bad in her life. She feels like she can't do it on her own. After 2 weeks of me staying in New York, I ended up finding me a job. I was working at Macy's Herald Square. I helped the customers, and I tried to make the front look good and everything. Every time people step from the elevator, they see the front. And if the front not looking right, then there's a problem. So I have to zone the area, and then if they needed help, I would help them out with the different clothing lines that they have available there at Macy's. I was working there for a seasonal position, so just to have experience. Now, since I have the experience and I've been working there for like 3 months, now I'm in the process of working there full time. I want to work there full time and also work another job. Because believe it or not, you need two jobs to stay in New York. I don't care what nobody say. This rent up here in New York, $1,000-some for a month. Come on now. I don't see how they keep. They shop, they do this, they buy clothes. It's like every week, every day they be shopping. They just have to go in there to just get one outfit to wear for the bar or to go to the club or whatnot. But they really crazy about Macy's. Oh my goodness. They love them some Macy's. New York people love them some Macy's. I like Macy's too. I just didn't know they had good clothes like that. Everybody in New York is about fashion. Everybody have their own way, their own unique style. It's very interesting. I've never been in a city where everybody have their own unique style and their own way of life. Everybody's like free-spirited. It's like they go for it. And they will hustle. Trust me when I tell you, they will hustle to get that money. They singing in subways, singing outside, sing inside the store. They'll try to do anything to try to get them some money. Since I've been here, that's what I've been seeing. Yeah, it's a nonstop hustle.
Andrea Pavlak, the owner of a dog walking business. I know every animal that gets walked during the day. I know about every single visit, every single one of them. I know every single dog we have, every one of them. And we have about 200. I need to be able to kind of dictate what to do or what not to do, essentially, I guess. I'm the alpha dog. A doorman recently said to me, "You know, don't take it personally, but you guys just walk dogs." But we literally are helping these people live better lives. And we help these dogs to not get given up, because a lot of these people work so damn much. I'm going to work 15 hours. My dog is still in a crate. Oh my God, I have to work, or I can't go to this meeting, or I can't have this date. One client that I have, I think he's in his 20s. He lives in a penthouse. He's one of those kids who's made tons of money and doesn't know what to do with it. He has like 7 couches because he can't figure out which one to keep, you know? At one point, apparently, one of the dog walkers that he had before brought up some issues with him, so he fired them. So now he hired us. I'm just like, "Hey, dude, this is what you have to do." I'm not going to fluff it for him, but you know, I'm constantly getting calls like, "Hey, get my dogs, I'm going on 3 dates. He tells me all his personal stuff. I know all about his dating world now, and I just walk his dog. Does this woman know she's number 3 for the night? He's like the bachelor, but can't deal with the responsibility. I get a cheese Danish every single day because I have no time for anything else in the morning. I usually do the morning walks because I don't want to burn out my dog walkers, so I burn myself out. And while I'm doing this, I'm sending schedules for everyone to make sure, because sometimes so much has changed since a few hours before. I have to make sure I send everybody their schedules before I even get to my first dog, to make sure that everybody is on time, to make sure that everybody has everything. Every appointment that they go to visit a dog, they have to send me a photograph and an update on what happened. There's not one appointment that goes by without me knowing about what happened to it. The photographs are really, really good. At this point, I think I've downloaded like 15,000. We see our photographs on people's Christmas cards. All day long, we send photographs and an update. She took a quick walk out, peed, had a nap, pooped, had a snack while I freshened her water, all is well. But then we created this monster. A few people are expecting these things now in the middle of their work. Or I get, "Hey, Andrea, what happened to Peanut? Is he okay?" And then, "What do you think of Peanut?" And, "What do you think we should do about blah, la 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 la?" And now I'm finding out from this one woman who's pregnant. She's like, "Andrea, what do we do? We're pregnant." "I don't know." I just hired a guy who's a comic, who's going to be really, really funny. I can only imagine the stuff he's going to be writing because he's so funny and observant. Sometimes he speaks in the dog's voice. He is very good at becoming the dog. He does it really well, and it's what makes people want to work with him. But I think people love me as their alpha dog. They trust me with everything. While I'm walking a dog with one hand, I'm texting with my other hand, I'm responding to new inquiries, and I'm also invoicing while I'm on the subway because, you know, I'm always behind on invoicing. So the day essentially turns into about 4 hours of really intense, are you there yet? Are you not there yet? You're not there yet? It never ends. It's not just traffic you've got to watch for, and not just people that hate dogs. It's the other dogs. It is like gang warfare. You'll see somebody who will walk maybe 7 Frenchies, or there's one guy who walks all brown dogs together. You have to worry about other dog walkers because now we have these packs of dogs walking on the streets. You have to dodge them or else you have these brawls. Dogs are pack animals. That's how they protect themselves. So now we have one dog that's just going bonkers, and then they all go crazy. It's wiped me out a few times. We have so much stress. I mean, just to live here, you miss one step and it's over, you know? Skip a couple months of rent and you'll go to court. You'll never get a lease again. It's done. Maybe it's not fearful as much as like always trying to get a step ahead mode. Maybe I just don't want to end up being homeless because, I don't know, people give up in the city here. They think once you're out, you're out.
Zach Arkin, a former cab driver. In order to make it, you've got to connect with people. You got to be creative and you got to go outside the box. If nothing works, you have 1 second to do something. You've got that one chance. Say it. Do it. Show up on time. Do the job. Know what you want to do. Ask if you need help. Go the extra mile. Don't gossip. Keep your hand out of your pockets. It's a New York thing. Driving a cab, I used my skill, which was connecting with people in the cab. I would drive Sunday morning, and I'd go up to Harlem on the way up to the churches. In the summertime, hot, sweltering heat, I knew my friend was up in the barrio in Spanish Harlem. Being in a cab gave us power because you had mobility. You shot through cultures, neighborhoods. You shot through levels. You had a virtual reality. That's why art is fascinating with the textures. In New York, people are the textures. Every breath that you take, you have to realize that you have an opportunity. And so if you let New York swallow you, you're going to be sorry. It's up to you. You have to help people. But they're going to help you. There's a balance of life, you know, and it always comes back. Never worry about getting repaid and don't get caught up in the money. Don't get caught up over living in a particular place. You may be living where it is. Have fun. Who cares if you're on fucking Fifth Avenue in Trump Tower and you're in a fucking tenement? You go meet a girlfriend and you fall in love. People can find love. It's hard. It's a thing that you can't buy. You can't buy New York. You've got to live it. You have to live New York every second. Otherwise, you don't get it. Go out to the burbs. The thing about New York is the eyeballs. You have to make contact with people in New York. If you don't, they're going to put one over on you. Why do people get robbed in New York? They turn away. Do you notice that? Don't ever turn away from someone. New Yorkers eyeball you, make you stay in the eye. For me, it was, what am I all about? Look in the mirror. What do you want? You know, for me, working was the thing that kept me going. If I didn't work, I was depressed. You redefine yourself through work. You can have a business. You can do whatever you want to do. If you don't do it, it's because you didn't want to do it. You didn't want to put your money into it. You're not into it. So don't tell me you can't make it in New York because you didn't want to make it in New York. There's no other bottom line.
D. John Santos, a street bookseller and author. Thousands of people tell me, oh, you're the author? See, that's why I publish my picture on the back cover. Once they see that, it gives them more of a reason to buy it. It gives them more incentive. One lady, she was behind me in her car, and she heard me say, I'm the author. She got out of the car and said, why are you telling people you the author? I know you're not the author. I'm like, I'm just doing this to try and make a little money. This and that. She was like, well, if you was the author, I'd buy all your books. I ain't say anything. I just went like this. Look at that picture. She looked at me, and looked down. She ain't say a word. When I first started selling books, it was authors everywhere. Jamaica Avenue, you'd see about 10 authors. Everybody had their book stands set up, selling their books. Either they call it urban fiction or street literature or hood books. But I don't label my books that no more. I call it crime fiction. I don't want myself in a box, like for only one group of people. I don't do that because you paint yourself into a certain corner. It was authors here, authors there, people selling.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.